disclaimer. The views of the guest and even the host sometimes are not necessarily the views of the Work With Me podcast and Ruse Advisors.
Welcome.
Work. The interview. Preparing for the interview. Picking your final candidate. Going over the offer. Onboard training. Being let go. All things work-related from the employee and employer side are fair game here at the Work With Me podcast. Interact with us at workwithmepodcast.com, email us at bob@ruseadvisors.com, or lorindy@ruseadvisors.com. Your tough boss is Lorindy Ruse. Your slacking employee is Bob Stei. And the fun starts now. And who has more fun than we do? Nobody, I say. How ya doing, everybody? It's the Work With Me podcast. I'm Bob Stei. Ryan Knock. I should know that because it's Knock It Out Music. And not only was he fun and interesting and funny, but Ryan let us know that our delete button works because I used it 5 times, I think. Great interview with Ryan. Check him out. Knock It Out Music. Today, back to the real estate side. Derek Hall is joining us from Charter Real Estate School. From what I hear about Derek, it's cool. Is besides all this stuff, he's a real movie TV geek. So we're going to geek it up with him a little bit. And you can reach out to us, bob@ruseadvisors.com, lorindy@ruseadvisors.com, and check out our website, workwithmepodcast.com and ruseadvisors.com. And this podcast, you can hear it at workwithmepodcast.com, also in the radio at 1023HD2 KKNH, where classic rock lives, and tickradio.com. So, we spend so much time talking about the jobs, getting fired, weird things that happen at work. What about the interview side? Now, you've heard so many stories about me and some of the dangers I've had at work. There have been plenty of times in my life where I have been the interviewer. And one thing just stuck out the other day is back in, 1995. I'm working at a radio station in Baltimore, which is still there, one of the biggest stations in America, WIYY 98 Rock. And I'm promoted to be the new research director. And what we basically did back then is we'd call people up, like telemarketers, and ask them their radio listening habits. Our department lead left, taking our job in the building, and I was promoted to his job. Now, we had some time off in between this, so I lost half my staff. So I had to go hire a whole bunch of new people and build up the team, which I did, by the way. I built up a strong team, and we survived, and everything was strong. Now, we put an ad out in the Baltimore City paper the internet was there, but nobody really used it like they do now. So we had an ad out, and a lot of people called me to respond. Now, usually, if you want to work in entertainment, you'll take any job possible, and you get excited about it. I interviewed a lot of people. I hired a lot of people. Some worked out, some didn't. But for the most part, everyone loved the interview because at the end of the interview, I'd say, all right, I bet you would like a tour of the station then. And they would get so excited. They would see some of their favorite DJs. They would see the radio booths, which is all exciting back then. Fantastic stuff. I don't know what made me think of this the other day. I'm interviewing a woman, and the interview's going okay. Not much of a personality, but nice. She's talking about, I believe, jobs she's had, how she'd be good at this job. And then, we get to the end of the interview, I'm like, all right, well, you know, I'm going to look things over. I have to interview a few other people, though, but we'll be in touch. I guess right now, you definitely want the tour of the station. And she looked at me and goes, no, I'm okay. And I'm looking at her like, you don't want to see the station? She goes, no, I'm good. I got things to do. First of all, I didn't hire her because of that. I thought that was weird. Now, years later, I got hooked on the show Curb Your Enthusiasm. And for those of you who don't watch it, the one thing I love about the show is Larry David, who plays himself, there's no filter in his character. There's nothing between his mind and his mouth that stops him from saying anything. And there's a great episode where his best friend and his agent, Jeff, and his wife, Susie, buy a big house in Los Angeles. So he goes over to see, and oh, this is great, and all, whatever. And she says to him, Larry, I guess you want the tour of the house? And he does the same thing. Let me pull up that clip for you.
Hey, La.
Hey, yeah.
Is this something?
Yeah, congratulations.
Thank you.
That's wonderful.
We're so happy here.
It's a beautiful house.
We sure are.
So come on, I'll give you the tour.
Oh, you know what? That's okay. I get it.
What do you mean?
Well, you know, it's bedrooms, bathrooms. I get it. I see it. It's beautiful. It's great.
You don't want a tour?
You don't need to walk me around.
All right,
get
the out of my house, okay, Larry? Just get the out right now.
All right, fine. I'll take the house
tour.
No,
I'm done. I'm over it. I'm turned off. Leave. Get the out, okay? Freak of nature doesn't want a house tour.
Susie, I'll take the house
tour. No tour for you.
The crazy world of interviewing. Hey, the crazy world of interviewing. Hey, we got Derek Hall coming up. We got a lot of fun headed your way. This is the Work With Me Podcast, workwithmepodcast.com, 1023HC2, KKNH, where classic rock lives, tickradio.com. Lorenia and I are going to interview Derek, but first a word from our sponsor.
Hi, it's Bob Stei. Look, anxiety and stress overload is very real, as life as we know it has just been turned upside down. Worldwide pandemic has triggered a stress response that has us feeling like we are falling apart. This roller coaster doesn't seem to stop. If you're experiencing panic attacks and stress burnout, causing a rapid decline in your health and ability to cope, and you've tried reading the books, getting therapy, and adjusting your diet, and yet nothing seems to stop the crushing panic and resulting fatigue, Divine Design with Alicia French can help. Through her own health and stress transformation and 6 years of experience as a functional nutrition practitioner, focused on narrow emotional balancing, Alisa has helped hundreds of clients get their health and lives back. Call or text her today for a 60-minute consultation, 509-638-4329, 509-638-4329, and tell her Bob Stei sent you.
Yeah. Okay, so Bob, I'm really excited to introduce our guest, Derek Hall, today. Derek and I have known each other for a little over a year by now, and we've been doing some really exciting things together in the real estate industry. And I'm excited to speak about this because, Bob, as you know, for Roos Advisors and the Work With Me podcast, this fall is our Coming Home campaign. Mm-hmm. We're coming home to real estate. So in our consulting and advisory business over the last 17 years, we've worked in, I think, every vertical, maybe not every niche, but every vertical that there is. 17 years, we've worked in, I think, every vertical, maybe not every niche, but every vertical that there is. And it's been really a fun ride. And we've decided that this fall 2020, as especially going to 2021, our goal is to come home to real estate. So everything that we're going to be doing is serving the real estate industry and serving those companies that serve the real estate industry. So Derek, welcome to our call today.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. So let me just give you a little insight as to who this character is, Bob. So Derek has a long history of sales and customer service and client relationship management in his background. He worked for Yardi, which is the second largest real estate property management operating system in the world. And he also with Property Shark. So eventually Yardi bought Property Shark. So Derek also worked on Property Shark with Property Shark, and he was the senior sales executive there. And then after that went to work for Envelope City as a sales lead manager, and then a managing partner for Blue Monday Property Advisors, which was a firm that helped property owners who were facing foreclosure to give them options. Instead of just looking at foreclosure as the only option, they had done a great job of aggregating professionals that could maybe offer additional solutions. And now Derek is the owner, founder, and president of Charter Real Estate School. And I'm not going to try to explain what he does. It's so different in that model. We're going to let him explain it. But he's been doing that.
I wish you would. My resume never sounded so good. That's fantastic.
Good. Well, we like to make people sound.
My resume never sounded so good. That's fantastic.
Good. Well, we like to make people sound good. That's one of the things we do here at the Work With Me podcast. So Derek, we're going to go ahead and jump right in. So let's start with your real estate school. What makes it different than any other real estate school?
Sure. So I started Charter Real Estate School based on work that I had done previously. When I was with Property Shark, I was the head of training there. So my job was to teach the clients, typically real estate professionals, how to use the product. And eventually we developed a continuing education class to teach the students how to use the product and get the credits they needed to renew their license as well. And that did so well that we eventually developed somewhat of a school. And we would work with lots of different professionals. We didn't necessarily bring in teachers per se, but we brought in, once we started building out our classes, if we were gonna have a class on mortgages, we brought in a mortgage expert. We had a class related to the law, we brought in an attorney. And so what I noticed there was that whenever the class ended, the teacher was like bum rushed. The agents were just running up there, take my card, let's do business. And it just made me realize, you know, over the years, I knew that, you know, real estate was or is a very, very social, and connections networking is very important. And I was watching this happen over and over again. And I was like, why isn't this happening more often? Why does it feel like this is unique? And so when I decided to leave Property Shark and do something different, a school wasn't necessarily on my mind. I went to Envelope. That's another tech startup that I really enjoyed working with. Blue Monday was fantastic as well. But those were always somebody else's endeavor, right? I partnered with someone else for Blue Monday. And I just had this kind of nagging feeling, I want to create this thing. I kept the idea of doing a school was always in the back of my head. And so I said, you know, with the experience that I'd had, this would be a great opportunity to kind of take that environment where you do the networking as part of the class and the agents benefit that much more. So you're giving them an instructor that has real world experience. Not that I have anything against the teacher, obviously, but you giving them a person who they could actually work with after the class. And they benefit from that because they're going to call that person. You now have someone that you know you can rely on, or you feel like you can rely on. So my classes are built around that kind of social aspect, that you're going to have a class with someone that you're going to do business with afterwards as well. So that's the thing that kind of separates me from the other schools that are out there nowadays.
Sounds like a great model. I remember when I went to real estate school and got my real estate license. Here's what I remember. We were in this kind of shabby office. It was part of a shopping center that the space needed to be used for something. So this guy set up a real estate school in there, and I appreciated him. I mean, I learned a lot, but here's my takeaway. This is what I remember from my real estate school experience. Was he told us, he said, what you want to do whenever you buy a home, get yourself the biggest envelope that you can, you know, so like one of those legal envelopes. And every time, you know, so like one of those legal envelopes, and every time you spend money on that house, you just throw that receipt in that envelope. And then you keep it somewhere so you know where it always is. And then when you sell that house 5 or 6 years later, now you have all those receipts. So you can see that the money you invested, how that bloomed into something for you. This is what I remember from my
Right. I mean, that's the thing. They don't teach you how to do real estate in real estate school. No. Yeah, they teach you how to not get sued, right? So everything that's interesting you learn is that's the benefit, you know?
Right.
You learn everything, you know, once you actually start working.
There certainly was no networking. No networking.
Right, exactly. Exactly. And you're kind of thrown to the wolves, right? You know, like for so many different reasons, real estate agents are kind of left hanging, right? So like once you get that degree or that certificate, you have no clue what to do. You know, it's then upon your broker to teach you. And hopefully they do, or a home inspector or an attorney. Like, you don't even know the people you need to know.
Right. You don't even know what you don't know, right?
Yeah, exactly. A lot of unknown unknowns, you know. And so one of the things also related to that is like what I found in the industry is that you have a situation where people have to take 22 and a half hours of classes every 2 years to renew their license. And there's a lot of stuff they don't know. I'm like, how required to learn anything you're not being taught? So I saw that as a big void as well, where like we need to be giving them an education that's actually beneficial to them, not just the credits they need. And so that's the things I built around as well, is like I pride myself on having topics that other people don't have. And like, you know, if a certain professional specializes in something, I want to make a class about that so more people can learn about it. At the same time, so businesses can grow.
Yeah, what I walked away with that class, the reason I took it was because I was moving into, this was back when I was with the self-storage company, and I was moving into property management. And the CEO said, if you're going to be managing properties and eventually helping me acquire and build properties, you got to understand the business of real estate. So he sent me to real estate school. And I left that class thinking, I'm really grateful I'm on the property management side of things. And I don't actually have to go out and do this.
Yeah, hustle. It's crazy. It's a hustle. It is a hustle. Right? It's a grind and a hustle. And luckily, like, I'm also able to build out. So like, I work with a good friend of mine is named Taiwan Anthony. He's also a property manager. And he and I are building out a property management certification as well, so that we can help people kind of transition. I think a lot of property managers start out in real estate. And so we're working on that. I'm working on home inspection, things like that. So I want to work so that anybody who does anything in real estate, I want to help you be better at it. So I want to do more licensing, do more of this education for the different aspects of the industry as well.
That's so incredible.
Another point, a lot of real estate schools
did start out in his garage. So this the shopping center.
That was the next level, right? Yeah.
He probably managed the shopping center and he needed a tenant. So
right, I got a school.
I know. I'll start a real estate school. No, I learned a lot from him. So the greatest respect. So let's talk about that. That really real estate, everything we do, we're always needing to make connections all the time. And we were talking before the show about a movie that you love where it's talking, you know, we learn about sales and the art of the sales. So tell us a little bit more about that, why you love that movie, what some of your scenes are, what your takeaways and what you still use in your life today.
Sure. So yeah, we were talking about Glengarry Glen Ross, which is to this day one of my favorite movies. And I saw that, you know, as a teenager, when like on HBO, some random night. I mean, I actually remember the first time I saw it because literally in the movie, it's a conversation. It's a bunch of different conversations about, you know, it's old salesmen. It's like almost like the sequel to Death of a Salesman. You know, it's just all these old salespeople. They sell real estate, but they're those guys that sell you swamp land in Florida.
So okay. Like
this sales group, and you know, it's got Al Pacino and Ed Harris and Jack Lemmon and Alec Baldwin. And just an amazing all-star cast. Men basically yelling at each other scene after scene and just kind of going through this life of sales. And it had a really big impression on me. I think most people, whether you've seen the movie or not, you've heard of things like Always Be Closing, you know, call for closers. These things come from Glengarry Glen Ross. And, you know, Alec Baldwin has a famous scene in there where he just kind of, he's like the, he's not the sales manager, but he's like the top salesman. And he's been sent from the owners of the company to basically to liven up this group, this office that isn't doing very well.
Okay.
You know, leader in the office and isn't doing very well.
Okay.
You know, leader in the office and everybody else is jockeying for 15th place, you know? So he riled the troops up and he decides to do it in the most negative way possible. He just starts berating them. He tells them, you're going to get fired if you don't make the top two. You all suck. We're going to replace you. You need to do better. And that's where he gets, you know, Always Be Closing, because, you know, basically they're not working hard enough. And that movie just made an impression on me at such a young age, and I've carried it with me wherever I go. And so, for example, like the Coffee is for Closers, right? It starts off with, the scene starts off with Jack Lemmon doesn't want to be there because he's the oldest guy in the office. And he's living his old glory days. Uh-huh. So Alec Baldwin starts talking and he doesn't want to have any part of it. So he goes to the back of the room to make himself a cup of coffee. And Alec Baldwin just stops the whole thing. He says, put that coffee down. Coffee is for closers. Coffee. You haven't earned coffee.
Right? Most salespeople need coffee to get started. So if you can't drink until you close, that could be a long day.
There you go, exactly. And so I think that's kind of the tone that it's setting. It's like, you haven't even earned a start. Mm. You know? Work up to this point. Like, we're giving you everything and you're just taking from us, basically. And so even when I started, when I was working in sales with Property Shark, you know, whenever my partner had a great month, I would buy, you know, we had the office Keurig. I would buy him his own kind of box of coffee for the Keurig because coffee is for closers.
Wow.
Like, the reward was he got coffee because he's a closer.
That's so great. What a great segue. So you studied psychology at St. Lawrence University. So
yes.
Has that been helpful to you? I also studied psychology.
There's a lot of us around, especially in real estate. You need it in this industry.
There's so many of these psychologists who decided they were not going to be there. You needed to either do research or armchair psychology.
Yes.
And you were feeling that attractive to me. So I know, let's just go into business.
Yeah. And you look, you're armed. You know how to deal with the psychopaths that you're going to encounter in any industry, right?
Like I'm including myself someday.
We have two other psychologists on the staff, you know?
Is that right?
Oh, yeah. So our VP of sales was a psych major as well. And then also our head of research was in psych. So we just analyzed the office constantly and all the, you know, so it was a lot of fun for us around there as a startup. Yeah.
Interesting. So do you use that in the work that you're doing now? I mean, has it been helpful or?
Yeah, like ironically enough, you know, when I was studying, I'm Freudian in my, you know, my disciplines. I was really into psychotherapy.
Okay.
But the class that I liked the least, that I took the most from, was organizational psychology.
Ah.
You know, business psychology. It was one of the highest paid professors in the school because it was that unique a discipline. If you somebody to teach that, you had to go get somebody great because there just weren't that many people doing it. So he got paid more than the average instructor. So that stuck with me.
Right. And
like the things that we ended up talking about how you relate to the people that are around you, it was a little bit like sociology. So at the time it kind of turned me off, you know, because like there's that kind of war between psychology and sociology.
Right, right.
So I was like, this is sociology. Back now, that's what I use more than anything else.
Right.
Organizational psychology.
Yeah, you just wondered how you made that leap from Freudian psychology into business.
Yeah, it was a big one.
that would have been a little bit of a leap, maybe.
Yes, yeah. So luckily I had a segue. That was a very good segue for me. That was one of my, probably didn't do the best in that class, but I learned a lot anyway.
I mean, even, so I'm a big, I'm a big follower of Jung. So even then, it's a little bit of a stretch, but not so much of a stretch, right?
Yeah, like the application's there. It's definitely there. There's a lot of personalities to deal with.
Right. That could be a, you know, how we apply Freudian psychology in the business world.
Oh yeah, I do a lot of armchair psychology. That's for sure.
Yeah, we didn't realize we were trying to get away from it. We were going to do it anyway, and then the joke's on us, right?
So. Exactly.
Amazing. So, any other? So Bob and I, you know, we love entertainment. We love metaphorical applications. So, any yes. other great movies or shows or lessons that you've been able to learn that you bring into your school and
particularly useful also okay. because and like The Godfather is like my mother's favorite movie. So I grew up, you know, I had a single mom, and so whenever she wanted to watch it, she wanted to have other people with us. I could remember, you know, just watching bits and pieces of that movie constantly. Like so much of my childhood involves watching The Godfather with my mother. Like mm-hmm. I'm even being woken up in the middle of the night to watch The Godfather with my mom. I know this movie very well.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of things that I took away from it that I don't know that the average person does, right? I mean, like Michael Corleone being such a suitable leader, I think had a lot to do with the fact that he was a soldier as well. He gets addressed enough. The fact that he applied a lot of what he learned in the Marines to being a mafia leader. At the same time, it wasn't like necessarily as instinctual as a person may think because his father was such a good leader. So the idea of taking, you know, to our point about psychology, right? The idea of taking things as a person may think because his father was such a good leader. So the idea of taking, you know, to our point about psychology, right? The idea of taking things you learn in one arena and applying them to another.
Mm-hmm. I think
an important thing that I took from The Godfather that I don't know that a lot of other people do. Like for me, it was like, well, yeah, Michael is a Marine. So he looks at these things a lot differently than everyone else that he's dealing with.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's something that I took away from The Godfather early on. That again, you know, starting a business, which is all about, I can do this differently, you know, is something that I can attribute to some degree to that.
And I think there's a good lesson there for our listeners who our employees or team members of teams that this sew in and be a really good student of what your desk is about, but also, you know, this constant desire, you will be able to progress more quickly when you look beyond your own desk. Okay. So when that opportunity comes, either for a promotion or that you decide to start your own company, you've learned some of those lessons.
Absolutely. Yeah, because what's that saying? Like, luck is when opportunity meets preparation.
This is the second week in a row. Right, we had a music composer and a comedian on last week. And I just told him, I said, I'm just going to stop talking, Ryan, right now, because you're doing my part of the show now. You don't even need me to be here. We talked about that last week, that it's true that you need preparation and luck, where preparation and opportunity come together. So Bob,
exactly.
Bob, I'm going to turn it over to you. I hope you're going to talk about that amazing, because the Work With Me podcast is a global podcast. I hope you're going to talk about that map that we got behind Derek's head that our posters can see.
Global perspective.
To break a little bit of the inside baseball thing, usually 5 or 10 minutes before we record, we kind of talk, get comfortable, make sure our audio is working. We had a show going on today, which I wish Lorindy you were recording, because in the 7 years I've known Lorindy, I've never seen her laugh as much as we did when we originally rolled the tape today. So we just, it's going to be a heck of a podcast. So I think as bonus material, we should air that.
We should. I should have been recording, Bob. It's, you know.
But yeah, Derek has got this great setup here with the map of the world behind him. It really looks like he's sitting at the anchor desk for like Decision 2020. So I'm just waiting for the red or blue dots to poke up on the map so I can
get the screen crawler going. Get it all going.
But I think Biden did get Delaware and Maryland since you last spoke. But it's a great
it's been a long day already. As soon as the Department of State here in New York made it so that we could do classes via Zoom, because previously there was a kind of a big process you had to go through to be able to do something like having distance learning, what they call it. So I've adopted Zoom literally since March 25th.
Wow.
I've been doing classes for months now on Zoom. And so this background, I think for me, is a proper distraction, right? The students are there, they have to listen, they have to pay attention, because we have these little tests. We have to make sure that, hey, put your license number in the chat right now, and to just make sure that everyone's paying attention. So for me, I even kind of, just like you said, reverting to the news, I sit to the side, so the map is more prominent even than I am. I want you to see the map. And so I think it looks like something that draws your eye. I like that about it.
Now, I love how you talk about movies that you like that pretty much make your psychology degree mind work. I do think of a scene of a movie that I watch over and over. HBO back in the 90s, and Lorindy and I talked about this movie the other day, actually, ran a movie called The Late Shift. I'm not sure if you've seen this.
Yeah.
Back when Leno and Letterman and NBC couldn't decide who to fill in for Johnny Carson.
Yes.
And there's a great scene where Jay Leno's, after he gets the gig, his producer/manager loses her mind and alienates herself from everybody from the network to all the guests. So they're in Jay Leno's house firing her, and the NBC executive has a great line where he looks at him and says, Jay, I was a psychology major in college, and I see what's going on here. This is an uncomfortable situation. You need help.
Right. And I remember The Late Shift. I remember that movie. It struck me as odd because the guy playing Jay Leno looked nothing like Jay Leno. So,
right.
But it was a good movie. It was definitely a good movie. And yeah, it's really hard to not look at things from a degree that you spent 4 years working on. It's like, it's just, those things never go away. And I think a lot of people that are attracted to psychology have probably already had that 4 years working on. That bug for it, right? Like, I was initially going to be a writer. So my plan through college was to take all the English courses I could get my hands on and just go get through it and start typing away the greatest novel ever written. But I just fell into psychology. I took a class and I was like, wow, this is amazing. And it just kind of really, really felt like it informed a lot of things that I was doing. And I was like, oh, this will help me write stories too. I have better characters because I have a better understanding of different mindsets and things like that. But after I got out of college, I was like, I'm still going to be a writer. I love psychology. That'll be the second thing. But so my thing was I need to eat. You know, it's always a good thing to be able to have room and board and things to eat. So I needed a job. So Property Shark was one of my early jobs doing customer service. And it certainly helped kind of the demeanor that I very, very even keeled, listening, very useful tools in customer service. And I think that informed me as a trainer as well. You know, they said to me, they said, Derek, you know, the people that call like you, they ask you questions. Like, people thought I was a realtor. They thought I owned the company. I was just able to communicate and I had to understand what they did. And so then they were like, the natural progression is you're going to start training. Like, we need to get you in front of the people as well. So it's always kind of, it's followed. I don't want to say a pattern, but everything that I do topples on top of everything that I've done before. So I'm really kind of happy about the way that's worked out.
Now, I'm going to ask you now, obviously 99% of the people who come to a charter real estate school have an interest. They want to learn more. They want to know, have you ever had that 1% where you basically got to stop yourself and say, why are you wasting my time? Why are you here?
we would never say that.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, think that?
I would, but yes, still.
I definitely thought it. Yeah. Absolutely thought it, presumably to work in the industry, but then also the people that already have a license, they have to take the classes they need. And yeah, you know, every now and again, there's that thought. I'm not thinking about anybody specific, of course, but you know, every now and again, there is that thought of, are you sure you want to be here? You know, and you know, with the people that are starting, I think, you know, there's a perception of what real estate is. So I was like, all right, I'm going to go to real estate school. And you know, to the point we were saying earlier, you don't necessarily learn those things that you're expecting about the industry. So there was a lot of, I don't know if this is for me, for people you know, just getting started out.
Right.
The doubts.
Now, obviously, it's 2020. The elephant in the room with every business in the world, especially real estate right now, is Corona. Yep. Things have changed incredibly in the industry, especially in New York City. So what changes have you noticed and how have you adjusted to this, Derek?
Well, I think the biggest change, especially in real estate, is more of a focus on technology. You know, real estate, people in real estate are probably some of the least technical people, not even to be negative. It's just the industry doesn't necessarily require technology. And so it's now dragged people in real estate kicking and screaming into modern times when you have to use the internet more. I've seen so many more agents doing podcasts, doing video casts, just getting more comfortable with putting themselves out there because there was a point when we were all locked in here. And so the smart people were the people that said, I need to capitalize on all these eyeballs, you know? So they just got on putting out video after video, interview after interview, just making themselves, for lack of a better term, a household name, you know? And so like the use of technology, the use of social media is the biggest change I would say we've seen in real estate, and it's continuing, right? So even though real estate was always able to work, but they've opened up a lot more than what they were able to in the beginning of COVID. And you see that there's people, the line, you see a lot of these things on social media, the line of people that are at an open house. So you right. can see that, you know, it's like, you need to see what we're doing, right? So there's much more of a opening the window to what the industry is kind of like, which is really useful. But for me, again, going back to like starting Zoom classes early, that now is most of what I do. I'm at the point where now I'm not even sure I'm going to go back to doing classes in person. I would like to. We're still not technically able to, but I'm curious to see how many people are going to want to. Like, again, you know, the education is a necessary evil in real estate. It just is. And I understand that. So if they can do it from the comfort of their home, they don't even have to put on pants, I think they're more likely to continue doing it that way. So I'm happy to keep it going. We can keep it going. We will. And I'm just really curious to see if it changes it completely in the real estate education game.
Now, when you get somebody who comes to you and says, Derek, this is my path.
If it changes it completely in the real estate education game.
Now, when you get somebody who comes to you and says, Derek, this is my passion. This is what I want to do with my life. A young person, what advice do you give them?
I give them a lot of advice because like for me, luckily enough, I'm still a small school. So I still have like a kind of a one-on-one connection with the people that come in, especially for licensing. And so like, I've had people say, like, I saw your interviews. I actually did my research between the different schools and you're out there more than anybody else. So like, I try really hard to be available to the people that are coming in, especially that are getting their license. So I tell people first and foremost, real estate is going to be your life. you know, a couple of years from now, you're going to turn around and realize that almost all of your friends work in the industry. That's mm-hmm. kind of the way it works. There's no 9 to 5. It's just, that's not how it works in real estate. A lot of people are thinking, yeah, I'll do this part-time and eventually maybe. And it's like, you can't. You just can't do that. So I try to, the industry is like. So I actually have a PDF that I give everyone who's considering taking the class, which is the top 10 things you don't learn in real estate school, so that they can be kind of informed about what to expect to work with working in the industry. And then I try to actually hook people up with a mentor. You know, like I have a student right now who's about to take her final exam. Her background is in banking. And there's another realtor that I know who's very good. She has a great business and she has a banking background. So I introduce them so that they can, because they will have an opportunity to talk to each other on a level that most other agents won't. And so I try really hard to give them mentorship, whether it's from me or from someone else in the industry, that'll help them kind of move them along so they can kind of get started with a leg up.
We're with Derek Hall from the Charter Real Estate School and the Work With Me podcast at workwithmepodcast.com, 1023HC2KKNH, where classic rock lives, and tickradio.com for him.
So Derek, this top 10, tell me 2 or 3 of the things that you're not going to learn in real estate school that you need to know.
So yeah, so definitely the first thing is like what I mentioned about the no 9 to 5. There's no days off mm-hmm. and working hours. Your clients are going to call you all hours of the night. Mm-hmm. Say, hey, agents call me all hours of the night. You know, like, I actually get classes. I get calls in classes. I get calls at night. And the agents are experiencing the same thing. They're so, and because of that, you know, people don't understand all the other people that are involved in a deal. Mm-hmm. Another thing that I teach them is that it's not just, oh, hey, I meet a person who wants to buy a house. I sell them a house. It's the industry is so big. You're going to meet bankers, you're going to meet appraisers, you're going to meet attorneys, so many other people that are involved. And so I often tell the agents, and you know, pardon me for using kind of this older term, but it's like, you're the hot girl, like, so many other people that are involved. And so I often tell the agents, and you know, pardon me for using kind of this older term, but it's like, you're the hot girl at the dance. Mm. You know, all the people in the industry want to meet the agents because the agent kind of controls the deal. So right. It's like, prepared to be wooed. You know, it's uh-huh. a bad thing. You know, people are going to take you out to lunch, you know, be prepared for that. You know, not, that doesn't mean that everyone's going to be your friend, but there's a lot of socializing that goes on that's going to be useful to you. It's going to be beneficial to you. So make sure you're receptive to that and pay attention to who's actually going to be of use to you and your business at the same time. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just socialize with your eye on the prize.
Amazing. So you thought you wanted to be a writer. So what are you doing with that? Are you doing anything with your writing aside from writing amazing content for your website and your
Thank you for that.
I noticed, but aside from
that's most of the writing that I do. Like, I mean, when I was younger, I couldn't, like, when I was asked as a 10-year-old, what do you want to be when you grow up? It was like a writer, you know, that's always been what I wanted. And I love what I'm doing so much. I don't even think about writing. Mm. That scares me. Right. I thought about that recently. It's like, I haven't come up with an idea for a story. Like, for a little while, I actually was doing kind of short stories. I have this character who's kind of like a James Bond type character where I was doing a serial where, like, every month I put out about 20, 25 page story. And I loved doing that. Uh-huh. Loved it. Loved the character, loved what I was doing with it. But then I just lost time. I wasn't able to keep up doing it. And I don't find myself missing it anymore, which makes me a little bit, but I do love what I'm doing at the same time.
Yeah, amazing. I'm going to turn it back to Bob to ask the fun questions.
Sure, and we are with Derek Hall, and this is 1023HC2, KKNH, where classic rock lives, workwithmepodcast.com, and tickradio.com. And I got to say, Lorendi, we're almost, believe it or not, at 20 podcasts soon. It just came and flew like that. So successful. We've had great guests on every week, and they've all been very different. So a lot of that, you've booked some great guests. Nicole, who works behind the scenes, has got us some great guests as well. And like today with Derek and all his psychology talks been great. Last week we had Ryan on, who was a lot of fun. At the same time, he was so relaxed that, well, let's just say I had to edit about 20 minutes of bleep words out of the content. You know, my kids were looking at me like, Dad, why are you wrapping up your finger? I said, I don't know. My finger looks like it's been sleeping on a delay button like a cactus. But you never know what we're going to get here. So we're going to put you on a stranded island. And you can only have one of the followings. Let's start You can eat one food or one cuisine the rest of your life. What is it going to be?
Mexican.
That's a favorite. It's
delicious.
Yeah. Here's one for a psychology guy like you. One book to read.
I'm going to shut. I would have to be the complete works of William Shakespeare. Now I'm going to shut. I would have to be the complete works of William Shakespeare. Lot of stuff to read. I love Shakespeare. Shakespeare was my favorite writer. And yeah, you could just read shows over and over again, read plays constantly, and take some
from my daughter's in the Macbeth production right now, so I hear a lot of it at home.
Macbeth is my favorite.
So he likes Freud and he likes Shakespeare.
Yeah.
You need to know.
Exactly. Classical. I'm an old soul.
Now, just from interviewing today, here's the one that probably kept you up all night. You can only watch one movie for a movie bluff like you. What's it going
to
be?
I can't even begin to answer that.
Give him two, Bob. Give him two.
Why not?
Yeah. So, like, I'd say The Godfather would be one. It still just, like, lives in me, that movie. And the other one would probably be, I have to say, a Chinese movie called The Killer. It's directed by John Woo. And that, I think, is arguably his best movie. It's Hong Kong action movie. Like, it's just gun battles that, like, you've never seen before. I'm a big action movie buff as well. Like, I love comic books and action movies and Japanese cartoons and all that. But yeah, I would say The Killer.
Go check. How about one TV show or series?
Twilight. Yeah, The Twilight Zone. Love that show.
Oh, Twilight Zone. Okay.
Right. Yeah, The Twilight Zone. Yeah, not Twilight. No. Not Twilight movies. Twilight Zone.
I was going to be surprised.
Now, which one? The original, the 80s, the one from 10 years ago, or the recent one? Because to me, they're all great.
They are all great. But Rod Serling is hard to argue with. Again, as a writer, Rod Serling was tremendous. And so I love those stories because I feel like I've seen them all, but I probably haven't. So, like, there's always the discovery aspect of it as well. But then there's so many different topics at the same time. And I think the original series had a longer run as well. So, again, I'm cheating. So, yeah.
Sure. Well, speaking of The Twilight Zone, because I'm kind of a buff opinion on the 80s version, did you ever see the one with Robert Klein? He wakes up one day, and every word starts to change. And by the 2 days, everyone is speaking completely different language to them. It's really freaky.
I haven't seen that one. I'm going to have to check that one out.
Yeah, it's up on YouTube. It's called Wordplay. It's definitely going to freak you out. It's one of my favorite episodes.
It sounds like one that I would love. Yeah, because that's right up my alley. My favorite one is actually, it was actually the first one that they made, but it wasn't the first one they aired. And it was, it's, I think it's called Is Anybody Here? Or something like that. But it's a guy who wakes up in a, and it was, it's, I think it's called Is Anybody Here? Or something like that. But it's a guy who wakes up in a town, and there's nobody in the town. He's completely alone in the town.
I saw that, yeah.
He doesn't know who he is. He doesn't know where he is or what's going on. And it's just this guy wandering around this town hoping to find somebody. Yes. And at the end of the episode, you realize, or they tell you, that he's an astronaut who's actually in training to go to the moon. And they need to see how long he could be alone before his mind cracks. And, like, that's his mind breaking. That's where his mind goes. You know, at the end, is just like being alone is just literally being in this place begging for, like, another person around. And it's very profound for me to have that be the ending. After this, you're just confused because you're always expecting something to happen and nothing happens the entire episode. You're just like, when is he going to meet somebody? When is something else going to happen?
Interesting.
And it never does. And then it's like, oh yeah, he's by himself. And it's just him the whole time.
And what about the music?
That's a lot. I listen to a lot of different types of music. So I probably pick a DJ just because you can listen to that kind of music over and over and over again, especially like EDM electronic music as well. So maybe Psytrance is a big one that I like. So maybe Infected Mushroom. They're Israeli DJs. Phenomenal.
Have to check them out.
Derek Hall from Charter Real Estate School, where can people reach out to you?
So I'm on Instagram. I don't have like a regular Instagram. I just have the business Instagram, which is CNYRES, Charter New York Real Estate School. So feel free to follow me there at CNYRES. Our website, CNYRES.com. Notice the theme there. So I purposely named the school Charter Real Estate School because it sounds familiar, right? Like, everyone's heard of a charter school. And so it sounds familiar, but then, like, all the other schools heard of a charter school. And so it sounds familiar, but then like all the other schools have like these letters. So I was like, all right, I guess we'll just have to be CNYRES. But I prefer charter.
Well, we appreciate you hanging out with us today. It was a lot of fun, and thanks for being in the Work With Me podcast.
Thank you for having me. This was great. Really appreciate it.
Thanks, Derek.
Thank you for listening to the Work With Me podcast with Bob Stei and Lorindy Ruiz. Original score by Mark Ruiz. The show has been edited and produced by Bob Stei. If you have a comment, would like to advertise, be a guest or an affiliate of the Work With Me podcast, email bob@ruizadvisors.com. Copyright 2020 Ruiz Advisors.